Dot your I with this, Ohio State. Looks like another black eye for the Buckeyes. Just one day after Ohio State's football head coach, Jim Tressel, resigned amid accusations he tried to cover up yet another player's scandal. There's word the NCAA seriously is seriously investigating the team's starting quarterback as well. Have you heard about this? According to several news reports out of Columbus, the coach there, Terrelle Pryor, has been seen driving at least a half dozen different vehicles since he joined the team 3 years ago. And that's no crime to drive a half dozen vehicles, but hello. A number of those vehicles reportedly still belong to the dealerships. The NCAA wants to know who gave those cars to him and other reported gifts, because that's a potentially major rules violation in college sports. Now, keep in mind, Terrelle Pryor's already been sitting out for the first five games of this coming season after he admitted that he sold memorabilia in exchange for cash and improper benefits. That's a rule. That case is a big part of what led to Jim Tressel's resignation. He's the coach, because an investigation revealed Jim Tressel apparently knew all about what had happened, but never reported it to his superiors. With us now, David Cornwell, a sports attorney who represents a number of athletes and agents in sensitive legal matters. David, it's nice to see you.
It's great to be with you, Chet. Shep, how are you?
I'm good. I don't much care, for I'm an SEC guy, not a Big Ten guy, but I can tell you that I made a $100 bet with a buddy of mine who's sitting right there about 8 months ago that this man would not coach another day in the regular season for Ohio State. Sure enough, here we are. Are we in the middle of a meltdown here, or is this what are you seeing?
Well, what we're seeing is yet another college football program, and let's face it, Ohio State is one of the most successful football programs that we've ever had. And Jim Tressel is not only one of the most successful coaches, but he's been widely recognized as being one of the good guys
True
in
that.
College football.
In every way.
And now, because of lack of institutional control by Ohio State, and unfortunately,
Jim Tressel. Lack of institutional control within this context is a buzz phrase for what happened to SMU. You lose institutional control, you get a second, and you can lose everything. Ohio State is not going to lose everything. Why'd you use that phrase?
Well, because reports suggest that these violations of the NCAA rules were pervasive and very obvious. If a young man is going to be driving six different cars, trading memorabilia, sports equipment, which necessarily came from the locker room for cash or tattoos, then the indication is that somebody either knew or should have known what was going on. And in fact, Coach Tressel has now admitted that he knew what was going on and didn't disclose an email that told him about the trading of equipment and memorabilia when he had the opportunity to tell the compliance staff at Ohio State and the NCAA when they investigated. So it looks like one of the good guys in sports has essentially compromised his personal integrity to win football games.
Is it your sense that there is at some point going to come a meeting of the minds which ends in a sort of SMU thing? SMU got a death penalty back in the day. There's a 30 on 30 from ESPN that puts it all out there, but SMU got slapped down and put down, and that was it. Is there a day coming? Because every college football fan knows. I mean, if you're a real fan, you know there's stuff going on back there. Whether you've seen it or not, whether you have personal knowledge of it or not, you know what's happening. And the road to this point for my good friends at Ohio State has been a very bumpy one, and it's been telling along the way. It does not appear this is new.
It is not new, and it's pervasive throughout college sports. And I hope that we don't stop the analysis and the discussion with the sanctions, which I think are inevitable. I think the discussion now needs to shift to a focus on the NCAA's amateurism rules.
Hello.
Those rules are not in place to protect the integrity of the competition on the field or on the court. Those rules are in place to protect the NCAA's economic interests. They compel these young men to give away their services essentially for food and a place to sleep so that the NCAA can make billions of dollars. We need to look at this and force the NCAA into a more fair system. And the argument that the NCAA ensures these young men and women in education is false. If we just look at the graduation rates, 50, 55% of these people are leaving these college campuses with a college degree. So if you don't get your education, the only thing you're getting is food and a dormitory room.
50 to 55% without a college degree. I dispute that set of facts because I know so many people who bring in young men who've come from small towns where they've been passed along all their lives. Junior high and high school, they were stars, and then they come into the academic center, and they help teach them. They get past the obstacles that have been there. There are good things that happen, but you are so right. You're gonna work for free? Slave labor in many cases. It's almost like slave labor as these institutions make tens of millions and more millions and billions of dollars for the NCAA. And what are they getting? You're about right. It's great to see you. I hope you'll come back again.
I'd be happy to. Thank you, Shep.
David Cornwell, a sports attorney, and knows what he's talking about.